Majority Whip.
Madam President, before I begin, I too want to join with my colleagues who have preceded me and just say how sad I was to hear of the death of Elijah Cummings. We joined the House together. He got here a little before I did in a special election in 1996. I came in January of 1997. But I always admired his fire and his dedication. He was a fierce advocate for his constituents and for the causes that he believed in. And the House will be a lesser place for his absence. And so our prayers are with his family and all those who had the opportunity to know him, his constituents, those he represented in Baltimore and the state of Maryland, who are going to mourn his loss today and miss his presence for many, many days in the future. Madam President, farmers and ranchers have gotten some good news on the trade front in recent weeks with the signing of a trade deal with Japan. U.S. farmers depend on access to the Japanese market. It's the fourth largest market for U.S. agricultural producers. And this agreement will remove barriers to the sale of a variety of products, from cheese to sweet corn to beef, pork, and wheat. But while this is very good news for farmers and ranchers, we have a lot more work to do on the trade front to help our ag community and to increase demand for American agricultural products around the world. And we should start by passing the United States-Mexico-Canada Free Trade Agreement. Canada and Mexico are the number one and number two markets for American agricultural products, and preserving and expanding access to these markets is key to improving the economic outlook for America's farmers. Over a year ago, the administration finished negotiating a strong deal with these countries that will help boost our struggling agricultural economy. To start with, the United States-Mexico-Canada Agreement will provide farmers with certainty about what these important markets are going to look like going forward. One of the biggest challenges facing farmers on the trade front right now is the uncertainty about what markets around the world are going to look like. The United States-Mexico-Canada Agreement will give farmers and ranchers clarity about what trade is going to look like with these two key trading partners. In addition to providing certainty and preserving market access for American farmers and ranchers, the United States-Canada-Mexico Agreement makes a number of improvements to the status quo. A particular interest to South Dakota are the agreement's dairy provisions. If you drive the I-29 corridor north of Brookings, South Dakota, you can see firsthand the major dairy expansion South Dakota has experienced over the past several years. The U.S.-Mexico-Canada Agreement will preserve U.S. dairy farmers' role as a key dairy supplier to Mexico, and it will substantially expand market access in Canada. The U.S. International Trade Commission estimates that the agreement will boost U.S. dairy exports by more than $277 million. The agreement will also expand market access for U.S. poultry and egg producers. It will make it easier for producers to export wheat to Canada, and much more. And Madam President, I've just focused on the benefits for farmers. In fact, the United States-Mexico-Canada Agreement will benefit almost every sector of our economy, from the automobile industry to digital trade to e-commerce. It will create 176,000 jobs, and it will raise wages for workers. So given the major benefits, not only for farmers, but for the economy as a whole, why hasn't Congress passed this agreement yet? Well, that's a good question, Madam President. The answer really is quite simple. By law, the House of Representatives has to take up the agreement first, and the House has unfortunately been more focused on political theater of late than on collaborating on measures that would actually help American families. And unfortunately, it doesn't look like that's going to change. I heard the Democrat leader down here earlier, Madam President, sort of attacking the current administration for not doing enough on this or that. Well, the fact of the matter is, if you look at the economic statistics over the past couple of years, they're pretty remarkable. Unemployment is at a historically low rate, 3.5%. Those are numbers that we haven't seen in a really, really long time, about 50 years, as a matter of fact. The number of jobs that's been created since the president took office is about 6.4 million jobs. And in fact, a very important data point, the number of people looking for work up against, juxtaposed against the number of jobs opening in our economy, for the 17th month in a row, we have more jobs available, about 7.3 million jobs available, than those people looking for work, about 5.9 million people. That is a historically sort of unprecedented, if you will, statistic. And so if you look at the overall economy, things are in the right place, they're moving in the right direction. Wages are up the highest level in a decade. The American people's pocketbooks, the things that they care about, the things that they talk about over the kitchen table in terms of their wages, their jobs, their prospects, their certainty about the future, those things have all improved over the past couple of years because of the policies that this administration has put in place, coupled with the work that this Congress has done to try and create conditions that are favorable to economic growth. And so what does that mean? Well, it's tax policy. We cut tax rates for individuals and families. We cut tax rates for small businesses who are trying to expand. We allowed them to accelerate their cost recovery, both key incentives when it comes to investment and expansion. And we've seen the results of that. We've seen regulatory changes made by the administration, in some cases cooperating and coupled with the steps that we've taken here in the Congress, that have lessened the burden for businesses that are trying to invest and grow and expand and create more jobs. And if you look at the energy changes, energy policy, we become energy independent, something that a decade ago or two decades ago nobody ever anticipated was possible. We as a nation now are actually an exporter of energy, a remarkable change over a short period of time. And I would argue, Madam President, largely due to changes in policy that have enabled and encouraged that kind of investment in energy, regulatory changes that have lessened the regulatory burden and made it less expensive and less difficult to create jobs in this country rather than more expensive and more difficult, which is what we typically saw in the past administration, and lowered the tax burden in a way that provides incentives for people to invest and to grow their companies and to pay better wages and add jobs. Those are the types of policy changes that have been made that have resulted in the economic data and statistics that we're looking at today. And they're not just data and statistics. They're actually being felt by people across this country. And so it begs the question as to why then another step that we could take on that road to economic progress hasn't been taken yet. And that is, why have we now, 320 days later, after the President signed the U.S.-Canada-Mexico Free Trade Agreement, has that not been taken up and passed by the House of Representatives? Well, Madam President, I would argue that if they would take that up, send it to the Senate, we would vote on it here, we would pass it, we would send it to the President, he would sign it into law, and farmers and ranchers in places like South Dakota and other agricultural states across this country would get the benefit from that. And it's not just farmers and ranchers, as I mentioned earlier, it's pretty much every sector of our economy. It's manufacturing, it's digital. There are benefits in this trade deal that translate into a stronger, more robust economy that will keep this expansion going forward and continue to create these good-paying jobs and higher wages and create that better standard of living and quality of life for people in this country. Well, the reason it hasn't moved is because it is up to the House of Representatives. They have ball control on this. The Speaker of the House can move this whenever she wants to. And what they're trying to do now is renegotiate the deal all over again. And unfortunately, they're very much obsessed at the moment with other types of activities in the House. And if you look at what's happening over there right now, it doesn't look like that's going to change anytime soon. With even the Speaker of the House joining the far left's now impeachment crusade, I don't think it's likely, Madam President, that Democrats are going to wake up one morning and decide that they should spend less time on partisan politics and more time working with Republicans to pass real solutions for the American people. But I do hope that they won't destroy this trade agreement. There are thousands of farmers in my state of South Dakota and around the country who are waiting for the relief that the United States-Mexico-Canada Free Trade Agreement would bring. And so, irrespective of what the distractions are in the House of Representatives at the moment and much of the partisan rush toward impeachment that's underway there, I hope that they can figure out a way to multitask and will do what they should have done a long time ago, and that is to pick up this free trade deal, pass it through the House of Representatives, send it to the United States Senate where we can pass it, and send it to the President where it can be signed into law, and the American people can continue to see the benefits of policies that are good for this economy, that will create more growth in our economy, faster growth in our economy, better paying jobs, and a better quality of living for people, not just in South Dakota, but all across America. Madam President, I yield the floor.